and welcome to A Healthy Mind. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser-Ledbetter, Director of Counseling and Student Development at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. On today's edition, our issue is obesity. Joining me to talk about the psychological aspects of health and weight is Ms. Deanie Jennings, a licensed clinical social worker. During her years of professional practice, she has inspired others to grow and heal in the areas of weight management, stress management, chronic medical illness, and mind-body medicine. She served for several years as a staff member and psychotherapist at the Medical Illness Counseling Center in Chevy Chase, Maryland, where she offered specialized therapy for medical crisis, chronic medical illness, terminal illness, and disabilities. Subsequently, she led psychotherapy groups and classes at the George Washington University Weight Management Program for 10 years, where she focused on psychological issues related to obesity. Deanie has received extensive certificate training from the National Institute for the Clinical Application of Behavioral Medicine, as well as certificate training from the Harvard University Mind-Body Institute. She is currently the clinical director of the Washington Center for Weight Management and Research, and also maintains a private practice. Welcome, Deanie.
Thank you for having me.
It is so good to have you.
Thank you.
So we are talking about obesity, mm-hmm. and it's everywhere in the mm-hmm. news today that, mm-hmm. that the U.S. is pretty much as industrialized and advanced as we are one of the fattest countries in the world. Mm-hmm. And of all of the industrialized countries, I think mm-hmm. we are the only country where the poorest people are actually the fattest people. Mm-hmm. In most countries where people are poor, mm-hmm. they tend to be skinnier. Mm-hmm. But in the US, it's the exact opposite. I'm gonna read a couple of statistics and then I want you to jump right in and define obesity for mm-hmm. me. But I really wanna frame the context because every time I read this, it blows my mind. Mm-hmm. This is the National Center for Health Statistics. And they say 68.8% of adults are overweight. Of those, 35.7% are obese. 31.8% of children and adolescents are overweight or obese. 16.9% are obese. 30.5% of low-income preschoolers are overweight or obese. And then, of course, the disparities continue by race, ethnicity, by SES, by you name it. What is obesity, and why are we all struggling with obesity?
Well, it's a very complicated matter. Obesity is a complicated issue. In our society, it's defined by what's called our BMI, our body mass index, and it's a calculation, a scientific calculation that takes into account your height, your weight, a few other factors. And one should find themselves, you know, fitting into a category of normal weight, overweight, obese.
Mm-hmm. So why are so many of us obese? What is really the problem? Mm-hmm. I rattled off statistics because mm-hmm. I like to, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. kind of frame mm-hmm. the conversation, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. really, why are so many of us?
Well, I think one of the reasons is because there's a poor understanding that obesity or being overweight is not just a matter of willpower or bootstraps that we have control over ourselves. Mm-hmm. We need to look at what I call the biopsychosocial spiritual aspects mm-hmm. of our lives.
Right, okay. Right.
Biologically, most scientists believe that fundamentally obesity relates to your biological predisposition.
So what does that mean?
Includes your genetic inheritance, what were your ancestors like, what's the tendency. It includes your medical conditions, the medicines that you're taking.
So what you just said, uh-huh. you can be predisposed to be obese.
Exactly.
Well, that's not fair.
Right. It's a setup. You're set up from the very start. Like you might be predisposed for a variety of illnesses, heart disease.
Yeah.
You might look in your family and see, is there a history of heart disease, cancer, of course, diabetes, and so on. So we're set up for it. Okay. That's number one. Number two, it's the biological side of it. Also, there are defects in the weight regulatory system in a minority of people, and that means hormone imbalances that trigger appetite when we're not really needing to eat, and and don't trigger our turnoff switch. Mm-hmm. So we've got a variety of biological reasons that we're obese. Then we put into the mix environmental exposure. We are in this society increasingly more sedentary,
yes,
yet busier.
Yes.
So that we're on the go all the time and sitting down when we're not. We have great exposure to food at relatively low cost compared to the rest of the world. And food is the major way, food and alcohol is how we right. socialize and celebrate and get together. And also food is how we comfort and soothe and relieve pain and
it starts
whole
so
variety
early.
Of things. Yes.
So we learn these. I mean, we think about right. the huge percentage of, I think I said, mm-hmm. 32% of the little kids are obese and struggling
right.
with food. And you talked, what you said mm-hmm. kind of reminded me of what I think of as a food desert. Mm-hmm. It how when you mm-hmm. can, especially in poor black neighborhoods, mm-hmm. you go into poor black neighborhoods and a healthy market where you can get fresh produce mm-hmm. doesn't exist for miles
right.
or for, you know, what I think mm-hmm. is reasonable. Mm-hmm. And so can you speak to that at all?
Oh, yes. I mean, you know, parents are blamed a lot for what they're feeding their kids. Well, if you don't have availability and access to the food,
right.
and you do have access to ready-made food at relatively low cost,
right.
what are you going to do?
Right.
And the problem is the kinds of foods that tend to be readily available, fast foods, processed foods, are the exact kinds of foods that have a great deal to do with why we're obese in
and
this
it's
country.
Cheap.
It's cheap.
It's cheap.
What are parents going
to
do?
Right. And you know, not that, you know, the mm-hmm. only place that we have to shop is Wendy's and McDonald's and places like mm-hmm. that. But you go there, if you want a salad, mm-hmm. you're going to pay $7. But you can get a really unhealthy Happy Meal or something like that.
Exactly.
For $2.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
And so it's really, it makes it difficult if you're out and you happen mm-hmm. to be wanting to grab something that's affordable.
Right. And the nature of those foods is that those foods are highly addictive. So the sugar, salt, fat content, the flour, sugar, salt, fat, the mouthfeel of the food, all of those things factor in. And the fast, readily available foods that are processed tend to have a real lure. So children come to love those foods very quickly.
So are they highly addictive because they're highly mm-hmm. addictive in the clinical sense, or are they highly addictive because we like it?
There's a subset of the population that has usually a genetic history of addictions of different kinds.
Oh, okay.
Who actually do become addicted to specific foods. Overwhelming cravings, oftentimes they're binging at night alone, can't help it.
So you're talking about me and chocolate?
Yes, exactly.
Is that what you're talking about, me?
Most of us.
Right.
But actually there's a biochemical effect on the brain.
Right.
Our food and our nutrition, you know, regulates our biochemistry. Mm. And mm. so those kinds of foods trigger our feel-good, the reward center of the brain, our feel-good part.
So let's talk about
mm-hmm.
feel-good
mm-hmm.
and why you say emotional eating is important to be in tune to. Why it's important mm-hmm. to be in tune mm-hmm. to your emotional eating?
Mm-hmm. Well, an awful lot of our eating is mindless eating. We don't really know why we're eating. We don't necessarily, we're not particularly hungry. Why do we eat? We eat when we're not hungry. We've had our meal.
Right, it's the dessert. You just gotta have dessert.
We've got the dessert.
Right,
well,
right.
Certain types of foods are associated with different feeling states that can make us feel better. So, you know, in our lives, it may even start in childhood, that we grew up in a family in which life did not feel safe, arguments, criticisms, whatever, alcoholism and so on. Pretty early on, people mm-hmm. learn to go back to the very beginning of how they learn to cope, which is to eat.
And so the food makes me feel safe?
Food makes me feel better. It changes our biochemistry, but we start to assign certain meanings to that food, like this is my safe food, I go and hide in the closet with. This food makes me feel like it's going to be okay for now.
So I'm going to take a leap and say we all have that, and then we may not.
Yes.
But I'm going to take the leap
we
and
all
say,
have
I
that.
Want chocolate.
Yeah.
Listen, right? So
we all came into the world the same way. The baby cries and you feed it no matter what the baby
right.
needs. So we start to associate with food, and this is for our evolutionary survival purposes. So please, people, don't blame yourselves when you reach for food, for comfort, or for feeling better. We're all wired to feel better so the species can survive. Mm. So we reach for food. again, we learned as children, as babies, you cry and I get my comfort or nurturance or pain relief or anxiety relief. I get talked to, I get held, and I get fed. Mm-hmm. So we all associate food as what I call mommy.
So is there mm-hmm. Some truth in mm-hmm. the idea that your mind is only about as healthy as your body, or is there no truth in that? Because I think about obesity in a probably very common way, and I don't know whether, so dispel it, because it's kind of a myth.
Mind and body are directly connected.
Yeah.
But there are plenty of what I'm going to call normal weight or thin people walking around doing comfort eating and that type of thing. They just have a different genetic setup or predisposition terms of holding weight or not.
So
we all have that predisposition to reach for food to comfort.
That's good.
That as we get older, we develop a broader array of ways of coping that, so we're not doing so much caloric damage or any other kind of damage with different kinds of foods. Mm-hmm. So we develop skills around what's called self-regulation, how to regulate how I feel.
And
in
is
life.
That what stops me mm-hmm. from being obese, even though I mm-hmm. like comfort food?
Mm-hmm.
And the next person might decide that they can't stop, and so they become obese?
They become obese.
Overweight?
Because, again, it's this perfect storm of your genetic inheritance, your emotional life, and your environmental piece coming in, the type of nutrition. You mentioned the food deserts, the type of food that you're getting. A lot of kids are labeled as hyperactive or behavioral problems when really the type of food they're getting is inappropriate. It's full of chemicals and dye and not feeding every cell in their body so they can grow.
Mm-hmm. And so, you talked about eating when we're not physically hungry.
Yes.
Are you talking about eating that additional bite of dessert, or are you talking about the process of just constantly eating and thinking about mm-hmm. what to eat next? Mm-hmm. As soon as you're done with breakfast, you're trying to figure out, what am I going to have for snack? That constant mm-hmm. feeding. Mm-hmm. Is that what mm-hmm. you're talking
yes.
about when you're saying, why we eat when we're not hungry?
Well, we're eating when we're not hungry. Food, there's a psychological factors play a very powerful role in that. There's a need to deal with life, a need to cope, to manage, and especially in this high-paced, high-stressed mm-hmm. life that many of us live. We're needing some relief, and food sort of becomes the one trick pony.
Yeah.
It becomes the one quick that I can turn to for my pleasure, for my stress relief, for my comfort, for even sometimes my anger.
Mm.
We push it all right back down our throats because we don't feel that we can have a voice in life sometimes.
Yeah, and it feels like the society has become so much more complex. I mean, I think about the days of farming, and things were simple, and you could eat whole food because it was coming out of your garden.
That's right.
And nowadays, the life is so much more complex. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have more than the generations past have.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of being able to manage life, the complexities.
Right, and so we also are getting strong media messages as well, social messages that come into play in terms of the beauty ideal, and we're getting very mixed messages.
You know what? I'm glad you said that. Because we've got a fad diet. I mean, we're, fad roller coaster diets all the time. And right now, we've got talk show hosts on the radio.
Mm-hmm.
And they're talking about losing a pound a day.
Mm-hmm.
And I just think that is so dangerous to put that information out there as if it's the gospel or as if it's the way to go. Because once you lose 21 pounds in 21 days and you're able to restrict that, that much in that short period of time, I don't know if you've learned anything. I don't know if you know anything more about your emotions. I don't know if you understand what's really going on with your body.
Right.
Could you address that fad diet and that, look at me, I've lost 21 pounds. That kind of bothers me.
Yeah, first of all, that kind of dieting sets up eating disorders because you can only, the brain, the part of us that's all about survival, we have a powerful part of our brain called the survival brain. When you have all of a sudden restricted severely and you're on a starvation level calories, the brain is perceiving a famine. And so that triggers a lot of anxiety in us.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people on diet say, I don't know why I feel so anxious all the time. Well, the brain is going, you're starving, there's a famine. And it's only so long that we can keep that up before we shift into binge eating.
Because the body never lies.
That's right. That's right. So the body's saying 911, mayday, mayday, eat the first thing you can find, start to hoard food. And we are wired for this. This is mm-hmm. not anybody's fault. Yeah. This is not about shame and blame and I don't have self-control. This is your survival of the species that we're not bigger than. So no willpower is going to get you past this. It's not about willpower.
So what is it about? How can you get past the point where, because part of mm-hmm. me says, even if you've lost 21 pounds in 21 mm-hmm. days, this is great because at least you've got some loss and you're
not going to keep it off. You're not going to keep it off. Like you said, there's nothing's been learned. This weight, to get to a healthy weight, it requires permanent lifestyle change.
How
it requires having the ability to sustain deliberate control over your food intake and your exercise and activity.
So let me ask you mm-hmm. this. So someone comes into uh-huh. your clinic uh-huh. and they are obese and yep. they've got the childhood predispositions mm-hmm. and all of the stuff that comes along mm-hmm. with obese. Mm-hmm. So they're a classic mm-hmm. case. Where do you start? Mm-hmm. Because so I'm hearing yeah. layers and layers and layers and layers, potentially. Mm-hmm. Where do you start?
Mm-hmm. Well, where I like to start really is, you know, I mentioned the biopsychosocial spiritual model. I actually like to start with what I call the spiritual.
Good.
And that is, not necessarily from a religious point of view, mm-hmm. but from this higher aspect of who we are. What is it that is your motivation for this?
Can people really identify it?
With a little bit of work? Actually, I'm very surprised at how people go right to it. What matters most to you? So this is sort of getting to your top values. Why would you want to do this hard thing? Because we only change when we really want it, because it is hard.
It is hard.
People start to say, you know, I'll say, what? Well, I want to live for my family, or I want to make my contribution on the planet. You know, I'll ask, what's your intention for your life? Mm-hmm. So that's what I call the mountaintop view, the bigger picture.
How long do you stay in that mountaintop view place? One session, five sessions?
It kind of, one good session, and then it kind of gets woven into especially when the hard times come.
You bump back into it.
Now remember, what was the motivation again? What mattered most to you?
Right.
And so you keep going back to that motivation when you're having a hard time.
Right.
And the motivation will inform you, what are the footprints in the sand that I want to leave when my life is over? Yeah. What are my goals? So that's the very big picture. Mm-hmm. Once we get that, you know, what's the work I'm doing? Is it soul satisfying? Is even if the work I'm doing is my volunteer work, I don't necessarily mean what you do for a daily wage.
Right.
You know, what brings my life meaning and purpose? How do I belong? Mm-hmm. You know, how do I give and receive love? That's the big stuff. Once we get there, I feel that there's an easing in people.
Mm.
Like, oh, I'm just not going to have to rely on my willpower and self-denial of food and restriction to get through this. I have a reason that I want to do this.
Right.
And it's my reason, not anyone else's.
And do they find it in that second layer where they're talking about meaning? Because I imagine mm-hmm. that there's a lot of, and mm-hmm. there's actually data to support this, that there are a lot of people that are unhappy in their jobs.
Right.
Right? There are a lot of people who they can connect with the idea that they mm-hmm. love their kids and their family. Mm-hmm. They can connect with, mm-hmm. you know, the spiritual piece. Mm-hmm. But when it comes down to work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're collecting a paycheck and they
have. And sometimes, you know, we're not going to like the work or the boss or something. And sometimes I'll ask people, is there another way you can think about your work? Is there another perspective? Because, yes, you're right. This is really tough.
Right.
And people, we may come to, well, it does give me the paycheck. Hmm. It gives me, I can live this life and support my family with this. Or what are the small things that I can get from this? Honing my skills or, you know, the beauty of something that was shared by a coworker. Mm-hmm. There are small things, mm-hmm. okay?
And what are they doing with that? So mm-hmm. I'm thinking behavioral mm-hmm. stuff is happening in between these sessions.
Right.
Are you giving them mm-hmm. homework? Where's the epiphany or the mm-hmm. aha that says, mm-hmm. oh, mm-hmm. I really should put this down because this is not fulfilling.
Yeah.
I'm just gonna feel a little sugar high. Mm-hmm. But, so my stuff's coming out.
Right, so we have that temporary feel-good from the food.
Yeah, right.
And then, of course, what happens is that we crash down off that sugar high and go into the depths of despair and lose our perspective. So a positive coping style is the next thing that I really like to teach people.
Okay.
You know, what is a positive coping style? Because that's associated with long-term weight loss and maintenance. Mm-hmm. A positive coping style means that I can see the longer picture. That yes, I have this desire in this moment for this thing, but there's something more important to me. It also means being able to get perspective about how bad is this situation that, I don't know, my boss just yelled at me, or my teenage daughter is defying me, or whatever.
Right.
You know, in the scheme of my whole life, how important is this? Get your perspective on things. Good problem-solving skills. Mm-hmm. Can I break? This is a big deal.
It is a big deal.
There's a lot of resistance about change because people feel overwhelmed by it. If you can break things down into their smallest piece, well, how much exercise am I willing to do? Because it feels scary to think about 30 minutes or half an hour of exercise. Can I get up and dance for 5 minutes? Well, yeah, I know I can do that. Okay, let me just do that then.
What about the youth?
Mm-hmm.
So the same, you talk about the youth and you talk about shame and how they deal with the name calling and the disdain and bitterness that comes out of being a little overweight or being obese. Do you have the same level of behavioral modification or recommendations for that population?
Yes, I mean there's a lot of teaching that I kind of wish kids had learned in kindergarten, you know, about how to deal with bullies essentially, but also how to deal with their own perspective. Like in the scheme of my life, that guy is really not going to matter that much. Also, to learn how to shift our own state. Something happened, it was really scary, those kids were calling me names, and that can happen in adult life too.
Right.
How, you know, what's my safe retreat? And I encourage people to learn to do a few basic stress management techniques. You know, come home to yourself through some nice deep breathing. Mm-hmm. And when I say deep breathing, I mean just breathe in a little, not deep breath on the beginning. Breathe in a little, pause, and release twice as long. So I was telling my 90-year-old mother that this was a stress management technique that had been researched at Harvard. And she said, they spent money on that? And I said, yeah, Mom.
They all know this.
Well, I could have told them that.
Right.
It's called a sigh of relief.
Oh,
and she was right. It's just
right.
A little in.
Yeah. That's good and even role-playing.
We have that. We know.
That's great.
Okay, 10 of those will change your brain chemistry into the feeling centered, into the relaxation response. Children need to know this.
Yeah, they
Let me
do.
Just run into the bathroom. It only takes 2 minutes.
Yes.
Or adults. Or let me run into the bathroom and run warm water
and
over
this
my
this incident does not define who I
exactly.
am.
Exactly.
Just hang in there.
Exactly.
You'll get past it.
And we
it.
Need messages of empowerment. We need messages of affirmation,
That's
how to
right.
do affirmations. Mm-hmm. We need messages of assertiveness. Mm-hmm. What are my rights as a human being? Mm-hmm. Do we ever talk about our human rights with children? You know, so, but the idea here is if you shrink away from the bully, if you accept those messages,
right.
and then it means that part of you believes what they're saying.
Right.
And
right.
the bully might just be the television set giving you bad messages about your body size or your
yes.
body image.
Yes, because not everybody is meant to be a size 6.
Exactly.
Or an 8.
And this is a critically important thing. A lot of people ask me, you know what, I don't know what my goal weight is because I'm never going to be what
right.
the BMI chart tells me to be.
Right.
The BMI
Maybe
chart,
never.
Remember again, that's an ideal that comes out of a scientific mathematical calculation.
Mm-hmm.
What you need to be is what you know you're willing to do to be at that weight. How many calories am I happy with?
Mm-hmm.
How much physical activity am I happy with and I'm going to engage in? So it might take a little experimenting.
Right, right, right.
And then be there and enjoy your life. So if you have a little improvement in your health measures, in your ease of movement, your self-confidence, you've changed some of your behaviors out of the grazing and binging, you know, that's success.
Yes, and then you can,
and
once
love
you
your
get
body.
A little, once you get a little momentum,
yeah.
then you can kind of go with it. I mean, I guess it's not easy, but you can get a rhythm and maintain it for a while.
Absolutely.
But give us a couple of key points on how to maintain it once we get there. How can we maintain
okay.
it? I know it's like more than you can do in a minute.
Well, actually, you know, there's a study that's been done on thousands of people that we know what the features of successful long-term weight maintainers are. The diet industry doesn't tell you that
a whole lot.
because they don't make money otherwise.
Right.
So what we know is, first of all, the group of these thousands of people who have lost an average of 66 pounds and kept it off over 5.5 years. First of all, these are not people that didn't lose and gain and lose and gain 3 to 5 times before. So we're not talking about perfect people.
Okay, what'd they do?
These people accepted that it's a lifelong process, that they need feedback to know where they are so they can intervene early on. I'm up 10 pounds, let me intervene. These are people who picked realistic weights rather than ideal weights. These are people who understand that the single biggest, most important thing you can do is increase your physical activity. Interestingly, in the study, it wasn't the physical activity, the duration or intensity that mattered. It was the habit, the frequency.
The habit.
Habit. So if you don't want to do your exercise, just put on your gym clothes and walk around the block.
Right. Because walking
just
counts.
Just reinforce, and walking is, that's my
counts.
That is my exercise.
You can get, you can
that's
burn some calories
right.
walking.
So also the positive coping style I mentioned, you know, having a strong social support network of positive people, that matters.
Get rid of the garbage.
Get rid of the, get that dead wood out of your life. They go to third tier in
that's
your life.
Right. That's right. Hi, Dee Dee. Thank you so much for such a wonderful conversation. I really appreciate it. And if you would like more information about the topics discussed on this program, you may contact Dee Dee Jennings at 301-518-0540 or the Washington Center for Weight Management and Research, the Navy League Building, 2300 Wilson Boulevard, Suite 230, Arlington, Virginia, 22201, or call her at 703-807-0037, or visit the center's website, www.wtmgmt.com. If you'd like to reach me, you can follow us on YouTube and Facebook at A Healthy Mind UDC, or visit me on Twitter at Dr. Sis. I'm Dr. Cicelina Grosser-Ledbetter. Thank you for watching.